Welcome to worship this day. We are excited that you are here and looking forward to sharing joy with you this day. Let us worship God.
Thank you. Good morning. I'm Kelsey Miller, and I am a member of the Board of Deacons. Please join me in praying for our prayer of illumination. Guide us into your word, God our helper, that we might hear the message for you intend for us today. Amen. Our first scripture lesson this morning is from the Gospel according to John, reading chapter 16, verses 1 through 24. Listen to the word of the Lord. Jesus said, "I have said these things to you to keep you from stumbling. They will put you out of the synagogues. Indeed, an hour is coming when those who kill you will think that by doing so, they are offering worship to God. And they will do this because they have not known the Father or me. But I have said these things to you so that when their hour comes, you may remember that I told you about them. I did not say these things to you from the beginning because I was with you, but now I am going to him who sent me, yet none of you asks me, 'Where are you going?' But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your hearts. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I go away, for if I do not go away, the advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will prove the world wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because they do not believe in me. About righteousness, because I am going to the Father, and you will see me no longer. About judgment, because the ruler of this world has been condemned. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth, for he will not speak on his own, but will speak whatever he hears, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, because he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. For this reason, I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you. A little while, and you will no longer see me, and again a little while, and you will see me." Then some of his disciples said to one another, "What does he mean by saying to us, 'A little while, and you will no longer see me, and a little while, and you will see me'? And 'Because I am going to the Father,' they said. What does he mean by 'a little while'? We do not know what he is talking about." Jesus knew that they wanted to ask him. So he said to them, "Are you discussing amongst yourselves what I mean when I said, 'A little while, and you will no longer see me, and again a little while, and you will see me'? Very truly, I tell you, you will weep and mourn, but the world will rejoice, and you will have pain, but your pain will turn into joy. When a woman is in labor, she has pain because her hour has come. But when her child is born, she no longer remembers the anguish because of the joy having brought a human being into the world. So you will have pain now, but I will see you again, and your hearts will rejoice, and no one will take the joy from you. On that day, you will ask nothing of me. Very truly, I tell you, if you ask anything of the Father in my name, he will give it to you. Until now, you have not asked for anything in my name. Ask, and you will receive, so that your joy may be complete." Our second scripture lesson is from Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 through 6. Listen to the word of the Lord. "Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be known, be made known to God." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I'd like to invite the children to come up for a conversation. We're going to sit here on the rug. Hi, Connor. How are you? Good. We have Elmo here, yes, because Elmo's cool. I'm going to tell you a story about this Elmo. Hi, everybody. How are you this morning? You good? Quiet. So we've been talking about joy, and I was thinking of things that give me joy. So I wore a scarf today that gives me joy. My son's class made this when he was probably about Connor's age. And so that brings me joy. Yesterday was kind of an icky day, but my daughter Sarah and I painted these wood things, and this is mine. We painted a rainbow, and that brings me joy because we did something together, but also I like the cool colors. And then I brought Elmo and these other things, right? So here's Elmo. This is birthday Elmo. Do you like to celebrate? Do you celebrate your birthdays? So in our house, we have this word, celebrate, and this comes out onto the table when it's somebody's birthday. And same with this. This is like a big cupcake. So we have this big cupcake, and it comes out on the table, and that's kind of a reminder. And then we have birthday Elmo. And birthday Elmo came into our life when my kids were really small, but they're much, much bigger now. And we still bring birthday Elmo out. So the birthday person gets birthday Elmo. And I had the most recent birthday, so I have birthday Elmo right now. But Sarah's going to get it in just one more week. And so then Elmo will be with her. And then we just kind of pass it around. So it's like a symbol that it's somebody's special day. So these are things that are joyful. And we are joyful for one another. Like, I'm happy for my kids, or I'm happy for you when you have a birthday. And that's kind of like God. God is happy for us when we're happy. And we also are happy for all the things that God has done. And so I was thinking on this last Sunday to celebrate joy, I want to invite you to stand up for a second. So there are lots of things we can do when we're joyful, right? We can shout for joy. This is a moment when you can shout in church. What do you think? You think we can shout as loud as we can? What should we shout? Like joy?
Celebrate.
Celebrate. That's a really good word. Okay, so let's shout as loud as we can. Celebrate! Excellent. Do you think our friends joined us? I'm not sure. Did you all join us? You have to yell, so celebrate. Okay, so celebrate. Okay, now here's another one. I'm going to invite all of our friends to stand up too, okay? Now, with the exception of our friend over here, Bill White, you're not allowed to do this, okay? You can stand, but you can't do this. Okay, we're going to jump for joy. Okay, ready? Jump for joy! Yeah, oh, I like your style. So you jumped and shouted. Now, what about dancing for joy? Do you think we can dance?
Yes.
Okay, now I know we don't have any music, but we all have music inside of us, don't we? So that means that we're never out of rhythm, everything's cool, right? Okay, so let's just spend a moment like dancing for joy, right? Excellent. Okay, so we hope that we can hold on to this, because sometimes, I don't know if you heard that really long scripture that Kelsey read, but sometimes things are really sad, and we have to remember that we can have joy, and the joy is much more precious when we remember our joy and our sadness. So let's do all these things one more time, okay? So you can choose your favorite thing. You can jump, you can shout, you can dance, or you can do something else, okay? Ready? One, two, three, joy! Excellent, okay, so let's pray together. Can you repeat after me? Dear God, thank you for the joy in our hearts. Thank you for the joy in our hearts. And the chance to shout, and the chance to jump, and the chance to dance. Help us share joy. Help us share joy with all we meet. In Jesus' name, amen. I hope you can do joyful things today, okay? You're welcome to stay right here. Or go back to sheets. just, you know, share a little joy.
Make this joyful.
There we go.
Thank you. I do. Mix your birthday Elmo. Friends, let's go back in history together. Long, long ago, in the beginning of beginnings, there was an artist that surpassed all other artists. So beautiful, so divine, this was the architect of eternity, the designer of infinity, the Alpha and the Omega of all masterpieces. She was known as the Great Creator. And in the beginning of beginnings, the Great Creator began to create. She would devote herself to a new piece, a piece of wonder and beauty. It would be considered one of her greatest works. And as she worked, time ceased to exist. How many days passed as she dedicated herself to her art? How many years, centuries, generations? It was just the Creator and her work with limitless time to dream and to create. Her fingers flew and her creation swirled. It was almost like a dance, a grand whirlwind of color and formation. There was separation, there was configuration. She shaped it all. Everywhere was individually designed and formed by her touch. Her fingerprints were on everything. They built up the mountains and they dug down the valleys. Rivers like ribbons wove throughout her entire piece, and she created lakes and ponds and oceans to speckle creation with ripple and movement. Lights bounced off these waters, devising a mirrored reflection of dazzling light that danced with the Creator herself. It was the finest display. There were trees that climbed their way toward the sky, and there were sprouts that flecked the ground with animation. Every plant was ideally placed to give her art a purpose. And after everything was built and created, after everything was shaped and crafted, and after everything was fashioned and formed, the Great Creator began to paint. She started with blue. There was blue everywhere, in the sky and in the waters. And then she painted green to hint at a world filled with growth. She used white and she used black and every shade in between to distinguish between light and shadows. There was contrast in her art. The sun was given gold and the moon was given silver. Every precious color had its moment to shine. And when the sun and the moon would switch dominions, she would use orange to signal the transition. She used red here and she used yellow there. Every color, every shade of color was painted into her piece. She had given beauty to this world. Her hands had formed this world. Her fingers had painted it. But she had one last thing to do before her piece was complete. With a giant gust of air, the Great Creator breathed into her creation. Every creature and creation felt her breath like a rushing wind traveling through the trees, up the mountains, and down the valleys. And with this breath, the piece was given life. And with that, she was done. Her masterpiece was finished. Every creature and creation bowed down to the glory of her work. They rejoiced in their artist. And she smiled down upon them. And in that moment, she gave thanks. And when the creatures and creation saw the Great Creator smile down upon them, they too rejoiced. For one moment, for this moment, all of creation rejoiced. There was still so much work that had to be done. The great creator would have to sustain her masterpiece, and eventually she would have to redeem it. But here in this moment, she and creation rejoiced in the work that had been done. She took a moment to give thanks for the gift she had given to her people, for it was one of the greatest gifts ever given. It was a gift to be shared by every creature and creation. It was the gift of life, and the world rejoiced. The practice of joy is as ancient as creation itself. From the very beginning of everything, the earth itself sang for joy at the notice of God's presence. Even today, when we look at the world around us, from the gateways of morning sunrises and evening sunsets, from the roar of waves and the strength of the mountains, from the flow of rivers to the breath of the plains, creation still practices joy. Over the last few weeks, starting on Easter morning, we've moved into this season of joy. Now, this followed our 6 Lenten weeks of practicing spiritual disciplines. During that time, we talked about fasting and prayer, listening and resting. But as we moved into Easter, we also moved into a new spiritual discipline, perhaps for some of us, one of the most difficult spiritual disciplines. On Easter morning, with a church full of life, we rejoiced that Christ has risen. That day, all of us rejoiced. And we, as a community, made the commitment to continue to rejoice, to practice joy, at least for the next couple of weeks, as we moved into our next series of practicing joy. That day, our sanctuary was full of people. But as each week has gone by, our Easter numbers have dwindled a little. And as we talked about sabotage and conflicts in numerous workshops, and as we move further away from the celebration that we felt that morning, we are still called to practice joy, the same as we did on Easter morning. No matter the present circumstance, whether it's good or bad, if we practice joy at all times, we move beyond just a fleeting feeling, but into a great act of faith. While it might be easy to practice joy when we have something to celebrate, whether it be God's love, grace, or mercy, it is a true act of faith when we practice joy in times of danger, distress, grief, or fear. While experiencing joy during these times of pain might be more difficult, it is in these moments where we believe that God intervenes and where we actually might experience our most valuable times of joy. And so truly, we must practice joy at all times. In our scripture reading this morning, we heard from Paul as he writes to the Philippians. I want you to think of Paul's joy. Now, if you know the story of Philippians, when Paul wrote that letter, Paul has accomplished a big part of his ministry. And empires, not just people, empires have noticed what Paul has done. In fact, actually, when Paul writes to the Philippians, he is currently imprisoned for spreading a message that the empires thought was too radical for the people to hear. Now, Paul, while in prison, knows that there is so much work that he and the Philippians still must do. They must continue to spread the gospel, live actively in their faith, avoid enemies of the cross, obey and imitate Christ, maintain unity, stand firm in the Lord. As I said, there is still so much work that needs to be done, and Paul is currently in prison, experiencing a hardship. But in his letter to the Philippians, Paul rejoices He celebrates the joy in what they have done and what they will continue to do. Paul writes his letter. He begins his letter by saying, "I thank my God every remembrance of you, always in every one of my prayers for you, praying with joy for your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. I am confident of this, that the one who began a good work in you will continue to complete it until the day of Jesus Christ." Paul emphasizes this joy. He uses this joy and the joy of the community as an anchor for all of them. There's an emphasis on joy because Paul sees what the Philippians are starting to do. The Philippians are beginning to distinguish things that truly matter from the things that do not. And Paul also notices that everything that matters is going well. The gospel is advancing. Ministry is expanding. The work that they set out to do is being done. And Paul believes that the work they set out to do will continue to be done until Christ comes again. So in that moment, as Paul writes to the Philippians, he tells them to rejoice, to be joyous and glad, because he believes that God's promises will be fulfilled. We could replace the Philippians' story with our story. First Presbyterian is beginning to distinguish the things that truly matter from the things that do not. And the good news is the things that truly matter are going well here. The gospel is advancing. Our ministry is expanding. The work that God is doing through us is being done. And all of us still believe that God will continue to use us to get the work done until the coming day of Christ when the work is complete. Think of every moment of God's blessing given to us as a community of faith. Think of God's current presence with us as a community of faith. Think of every moment in the life of this church that has been true and honorable, just and more. All of that is happening here. By looking at God's unending faithfulness in our lives and in the lives of God's people throughout time, we can trust in God's promise of future restoration. So look at God's unending faithfulness. The same great Creator who gave us the gift of life also gave us the gift of grace. The same great Creator who fashioned the world out of nothing also came down as the Word made flesh to live among us. Christ came as a humble servant born in a manger. He lived a life of serving others, healing the sick, feeding the hungry, performing miracles of all kinds. With 12 disciples and hundreds of followers, he traveled the countryside. He told stories and he preached parables. He lived out God's love for all of us, especially the outsiders, the least of these. And in his final days, when Christ knew that what was about to happen to him, he had a special supper with his family, the Last Supper, the Lord's Supper. He broke the bread and he poured the cup, and it was a promise to our salvation. And we know the rest of that story. Then the people who once loved him turned on him. The people who Christ loved betrayed him, and they sent him to his death. And Christ, the one true Son of God, who is God, died an agonizing, painful death on the cross. And with his blood, the red of his blood, the same red that was used in creation, The sins of humankind were forgiven with the gift of grace. On the night of that supper, Jesus warned his disciples of his impending death and of their own suffering that was to come. That night, Jesus tells his disciples of their own pain, trauma, and death that will come. But when Jesus told them, his disciples, when he told his friends, he reminded them that the Holy Spirit would be present with them in every moment, and that pain will not have the last word. In fact, when Jesus is talking to his disciples, he compares their present moment of pain to the pain of childbirth, which is why I wrote God as female in my creative creation story. He compares pain to childbirth. Jesus said to them, "Very truly, I tell you, you will weep and mourn, but the world will rejoice. You will have pain, but your pain will turn into joy. When a woman is in labor, she has pain because her hour has come. But when her child is born, she no longer remembers the anguish because of the joy of having brought a human being into this world. So you will have pain now, but I will see you again, and your hearts will rejoice, and no one will take that joy from you." In the creation, the world was given life. And in the resurrection, the world was given new and eternal life. And in both of those moments, Christ promised to dwell among us once again. So you have pain now, but I will see you again. And your hearts will rejoice, and no one will take that pain from you. No one will take that joy from you. There are and will be times in all of our lives where joy feels impossible. Whether from our own errors, the choices of others, or the broken systems around us, sometimes the present feels grim. And sometimes it seems that there is no end to this pain. But it is in those moments that the practice of joy, rejoicing in God's blessing throughout time, as well as all of the blessings around us now, it is then that practicing joy will bear its greatest fruit. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, in his last letter to his friends, while acknowledging the deaths of so many who died at the hands of the Nazis, urged his friends to practice joy. In that final letter, Bonhoeffer was worried that the horrific daily anxiety, that the constant threat of death, and the unceasing war would deaden his friends' souls. And it would, right? So he wrote these words to him: "The joy of God has gone through the poverty of the manger and the agony of the cross. That is why it is invincible, irrefutable. It does not deny the anguish when it is there, but it finds God in the midst of it. It is, in fact, it is precisely there. It does not deny grave sin, but finds forgiveness precisely in this way. It looks death straight in the eye, but it finds life precisely within it. What matters is this joy has overcome." Invincible, irrefutable joy. That is no passing joy. That is not just a fleeting feeling. That joy is God's joy present among us. A joy that was found in creation, a joy that was found in the resurrection, a joy that is found within each of us now. That is a joy that has overcome all things. In whatever season in which we experience pain, we can trust that there is always new life ahead, where sins are forgiven, justice is restored, and our broken world is made whole once again. Embrace this joy. Practice this joy, for this is God's joy. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, Mother of us all, thanks be to God for the word this day. Amen.
Friends, as we've been reminded, joy is a gift. It is a gift from God to each one of us. How do we practice joy? How do we celebrate joy? How do we share joy? As we think in these moments of response to the word proclaimed for us this day, I have two questions for you, and in a moment, I'm going to ask you to share your answer with someone. It could be the person sitting next to you. It could be someone else nearby. I would ask, encourage you, especially if you see someone that is not close to another person, if you might seek them out. Be mindful of COVID, keep your distance, but I want you to share. What is it, first question, that makes you giddy with joy? What just brings joy to you? I shared with the staff on Tuesday at our staff meeting that one of the things that makes me giddy with joy is when I take an old train, model train, tear it apart, fully clean it, put it all back together, and the moment of truth comes. You put power to it. And when it runs and smokes, man, I am full of joy. We won't talk about those other moments when the power does nothing. Second question is, so what is a practice of joy? Because joy is out there, but sometimes we need to put it back in our face. So I made a commitment to myself throughout Easter. Many of you have noticed, but oftentimes I have not done it at this first service. Bow ties bring me joy. I look at them hanging on my rack, and when I put them on, it's just this joyful thing. I can't even see that I have it on. I can feel it, but I can't see it. So two questions for you to share with one another. What makes you giddy with joy? And what is a practice, something you've done that in the past week that brought joy to you? There are other ways that we share this joy that God has given to us by being mindful of sharing that joy with others through the gift of our presence and our ears and listening to one another. And also in remembering the needs of others through the giving of our tithes and our offering. There are offering plates around the sanctuary. There is an offering box up here. You're encouraged to share the joy of Easter with others through your gifts, your tithes, your offering. And there is still a poster board over here on the wall that you can write what brings you joy or draw a picture. So if you would, what makes you giddy with joy? What is a practice of joy from this past week? Share it with someone near you as we respond together.
creating one, God Almighty, through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
Our judge and our defender suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light. Forever seated high.
I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in you. Saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is that we will rise again, for I believe in the name of Jesus, for I believe in the name of Jesus.
So I will encourage you to find your way back to a seat. So I don't know about you, but that was joyful, the cacophony of singing, talking, music, all sorts of things blending together. So in these moments of joy, let us turn to God in prayer. Let us pray. Holy God, creator and maker of all things, on this day we come before you with joyful hearts for the gift of Easter and the promise of eternal life in your kingdom, and the promise and the joy in knowing that there is nothing in life or in death that can separate us from your love for each one of us. We praise you for this Easter joy. And we pray that as we move through our lives this week, that joy will invade our very beings, will shape our responses, and will further our commitment to you, your will, and your way. God, we know that times are not always joyful. There are those moments, those occasions, when joy seems to be completely absent. marking the 1,000,000th case of COVID, death from COVID. Watching yet again another mass shooting, this one in Buffalo, New York. Mindful that all around us there are those in need, whether it is baby formula, a meal, a place to sleep. Lord, as we move through those moments, may your joy still break into our lives, and may it break through in our lives as we seek to reach out to others and to extend love, care, and compassion in the way of Jesus Christ. We pray for your joy to break into the lives of those who find themselves wrestling with health issues. For those in the hospital, Matthias Gutman, Bill Schaefer, Rich Woodham, Mildred Paulson. For those who have been discharged and are now at home, may they find joy in their recovery, and may that be true for Kim Daniels and Alice Schaefer. We thank you for the joy of eternal life in your kingdom for Mitch Dibbs, and we celebrate his life and ask for your comforting presence to be with his family. For moments that truly are joy and celebration, for Richard Pitts preparing to celebrate his 91st birthday this week, for George and Lois Hefner preparing to celebrate their 69th wedding anniversary, Ernest and Nancy Bellows preparing to celebrate 63 years of marriage, and Sarah Holler and Ben Lewis about to mark their first anniversary as husband and wife. Lord, in all of those moments, in all of their lives, may you bring joy. Now, Lord, hear us as we pray with one voice. In those words that your Son Jesus taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Before we conclude worship this day, we have a few announcements we would like to make. The very first is, if you have not signed up for a small group for the Lombard process, please do so. That is taking place the last weekend in May, and we want to have everyone have an opportunity to share their story and their history with the Lombard facilitators. This is, again, helping us move forward as a congregation into a future that God has secured for us. So please sign up for small groups. You can do so by calling the church office or by doing it on our website. We also have a very special faith formation opportunity this day. Right after the service in the sanctuary, we will hear from Ellen Smith. Ellen Smith has been doing work on behalf of our denomination overseas, participating in the efforts in Ukraine. So this is an opportunity to hear what we as Presbyterians have been involved with overseas in the war, as well as to ask questions of Ellen if you want any information. Particularly, some of us have donated to that cause, and just if you have a question, maybe how that money is being spent. It is a special opportunity for all of us. I also want you to mark your calendars for June 5th. We will be having one worship service that day. One worship in English, Arabic, and Chin Burmese. June 5th is the day of Pentecost. So mark your calendars, one worship service, 10 a.m. One worship at 10 a.m. Now, of course, right now in our life of our community, we have several mission opportunities going on. We give thanks that we have many opportunities to imitate Christ and to serve those in need. Found in the narthex, you will have the Bread for the World mission campaign. This is an opportunity for us to urge politicians to make ending world hunger a priority. We also have more information on an upcoming mission project called Par for the Cause. And I'm actually going to invite Doug Steinbaugh forward, who will give us a minute for mission and ministry on this great effort that we are doing as a community. Doug, it's all over to you.
Thank you, Taylor. I would like to introduce you to a church event that will take place on August 19th. The name of the event is Par for the Cause. Par for the Cause is a fundraiser disguised as a golf outing. My name is Doug Steinbaugh. My wife Alice and I are leading the organizing committee for this year's event. Par for the Cause will take place on August 19th at the Allentown Municipal Golf Course, right next door. Par for the Cause is a fundraiser with proceeds going to the downtown YMCA Warming Center. The Warming Center is a clean, warm, and safe facility for the homeless to spend the night and obtain a meal during the winter months. Last year, the golf outing raised more than $20,000 for the YMCA Warming Center. Over the last several years, the event has raised well over $100,000. A significant portion of the fundraising comes from sponsor donations. In return, the sponsors obtain exposure to the golf outing participants. Another source of funds is church member donations. 100% of sponsor and church member donations are passed through the church directly to the YMCA Warming Center. The cost of the event is paid for by the golfers. There are four ways that we, the members, can participate in Par for the Cause. First, we can play in the event. Second, we can be part of the effort to seek sponsor donations. Third, we can volunteer to help during the event and the week leading up to the event. And fourth, we can make a donation. And new this year, as part of number four, the mission committee has established a $2,500 challenge to us, the members of this church. Every dollar that we members donate to the event will be matched by the mission committee, up to $2,500. This is an opportunity to raise $5,000 for the Warming Center right here within the church. We're happy to answer any questions that you may have after the service. We have a table in the narthex with more information. Thank you in advance for your consideration.
All right, let's stand up and sing one. Ooh, that's a little, that is hot. Let's fix that. Sorry, you can all see my work process as I try to reduce feedback. It's fun, isn't it? How's that? That may be a little better. All right, we'll see. You can still hear me, I'm plenty loud enough. All right, you may remember this one. We did it like a ton of times in alternative worship once upon a time. We just did a segment of it, like a lot, like ad nauseum we did it, but we still love this song, the whole thing. So we're gonna sing the whole thing. Let's all do that together. My story, you will hear.
Truly couldn't have ended the service any better with my words, so that is our charge, to go out and to tell your story and use it as a way to practice joy. Now friends, we are about to start our adult faith formation opportunity, so for those of you who are interested, feel free to stay in the sanctuary. For those who are ready to go out and spread God's peace, feel free to exit the sanctuary. And now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with all of us this day till the end of all days. And all of God's people said together, Amen. Amen.